will be following the draft of Samuel Black. Sam Black is a notable Magic the Gathering professional, and we'll look at his first pick here. So we see a couple cards, some free spells, Plentiful Dead, Fire Shaman. I see a Fire Shaman being moved up to the front in, together with a Guilt Demon, a Corpse Monger, and a Misguide Herald. So looking like Sam Black highly values cards that banish cards from the discard pile, judging from that Guilt Demon and the Corpse Monger.
Yeah, it looks like he's looking at all three of these zero-cost cards. I think he is looking for cards that get additional value without spending the gold early. And in Cube Draft, it's a lot easier to get that investment in certain alignments. So that makes cards that are a lot harder to draft in Dark Draft a lot better here.
All right. And so we saw him first pick the
Fire Shaman.
The Fire Shaman, indeed.
Right.
And there we see on camera the Misguide Herald that he declined to pick but moved up. And here we see the actual Fire Shaman. And he's moving to the front for his second pick, two cards that pair well with the Fire Shaman. Fire Shaman, obviously, a card that needs a lot of support in the same color. It's a wild card that has an ally ability, meaning to trigger the Fire Shaman's ability, you'd need to play a wild card that costs gold. The wild card that costs gold that Sam Black just picked is Strafing Dragon. Pretty good card, I think.
Oh yeah, and a deck that just wants to attack your opponent and, you know, deal with the board, Strafing Dragon can kill a threat, or it can just attack for 11 in one turn. And in a deck that's wilds, I mean, that's exactly what you want to do.
Yeah, Strafing Dragon basically always attacking when it comes into play, either through Ambush, the ability that makes it so that you can play it on your opponent's turn, or through Blitz. Makes it a good threat quickly. And we'll see what Sam is looking to pair it with here. He moved a Trasher Demon to the front and some more free spells once again. We see Hasty Retreat and Rage. Rage, a what we call a pump spell, an event that lets you make a champion bigger. It also gives Breakthrough, letting you break through those pesky tokens that sometimes run around in Epic.
It'll be interesting to see if he takes the Rage and then someone else takes the Hasty Retreat, if that comes back to bite him.
Yeah, Hasty Retreat pretty good against the pump spells and other things that, you know, make champions bigger or more important, because it's a free way to get rid of an attacker.
I mean, that being said, if I had to have a champion Hasty Retreated and he was a Strafing Dragon, I don't think I would mind all too much.
That's very true. That enter play ability is definitely very strong. So let's see what he's looking at now. I saw a Cave Troll in there and a Burrowing Worm. Looks like he's shipping those over. So far it's looking like Sam's looking to draft something fairly aggressive.
Oh yeah. In fact, I think with the Rage and the Fire Shaman and the Strafing Dragon, he's really building a deck that can pressure his opponent and kill it, finish him off.
Yeah, we've seen this in Constructed, the burn strategy, basically, where we throw direct damage at the opponent as much as possible, flame strikes, fireballs. So I'm interested to see. Yeah, so here Sam takes the Wolf's Companion, I think he took. Nope, that's still in the pack. Did you see what he picked?
It looks like he took the Resurrection.
The Resurrection. All right, so choosing to go with a draw two over the Wolf's Companion, which would have kept him in his colors. I guess Resurrection pretty good with a Strafing Dragon as well.
I mean, another fantastic play. You know, if you attack with the Strafing Dragon, they remove it with a, you know, say they play an Ice Drake and block, or they have some kind of removal to finish it off, like a Drain Essence, and you resurrect and smash their face again, then I mean, they're not going to be all too happy about that.
Yeah. And so here we see Sam take a Battle Cry, another pump spell, this one for the whole team. So sticking to that aggressive slant here so far. He's got lots of wild cards. So despite the fact that in Epic, because there are no, land resources or things that force you to stick to a color, Sam is definitely choosing to try and get payoff on that fire shaman.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting, I think, that he picked the battle cry over the lash.
Yeah, lash obviously a free spell and also pretty good aggressively. It gives 4 extra offense and you can recall it from your discard pile. I guess Sam probably figured, you know, you need enough draw 2 spells in your limited decks, ways to keep up, you know, the amount of cards in your hands. And Battlecry does sort of a dual purpose of both helping you attack and letting you draw cards when necessary.
It's true. Andy already has the rage, so, you know, Lash might be a bit redundant, and he's looking to get some more variety in his deck.
Yeah, and there's always the chance that it might come back to him, so we'll see if that happens.
All right, so there he took the Force Mage Apprentice. I think that as far as cards go, that's another pretty aggressive card. At least it can be used that way. If, you know, you have a lot of Sage cards, you can burn someone out with Force Mage Apprentice if they're low on health. And it's also a great answer to cheap zero-cost champions. And we saw a lot of those at the very beginning of the draft, you know.
Yeah, and indeed, at the very beginning of the draft, we saw Sam Black consider taking the Coursemonger, maybe even for his first pick. And that came back to him, so he must be happy about that.
Yeah, and, you know, that Guild Demon got taken, so if... end of the turn, your opponent plays a Guild Demon because they want to banish something that you have in your discard pile, or even if they play it on their turn and then it comes back around to you, having a zero-cost champion that can take the board back and then keep the pressure on, you know, they need to deal with that Force Mage Apprentice. So it's either going to deal damage to them every turn or start clearing off small champions.
Yep. And here we see the last pickup of this first pack is a Jungle Queen. I'm pretty sure... So I'm not unhappy to see that in his predominantly wild deck so far.
I mean, we'll have to see if he can ever get that Burrowing Worm of the Jungle Queen. Things will go pretty.
Yeah, so it's looking like there was a not... he did indeed pick a Wolf's Companion. I think there might have been 2 in that pack.
Yes.
Little oddity there. But, you know, show must go on, so...
Well, if he's looking to pick more wild cards, big champions with tribute abilities, then Jungle Queen can be really threatening for an opponent. Even if you don't have anything in your hand, just the threat of it hitting the table, knowing that your opponent has a lot of wild cards in their deck, they might not want to be facing down an ambushed Kong or a T-Rex or a Triceratops, and all those things can be pretty scary if you don't know what's in your opponent's hand, and you know they start the turn off with the Jungle Queen.
Yeah, you mentioned surprise attack. We saw that on camera yesterday in the constructed match. We saw a lot of like champions with very strong loyalty and tribute abilities entering play on the opponent's turn, causing big swings. And the Jungle Queen basically produces that effect for all your wild champions.
That's true.
So we'll see if Sam gets rewarded and maybe, you know, picks up one or two of those big Kong type effects.
Not to mention, your opponent will never expect you to play a Fire Shaman on your opponent's turn.
That's also a good one. Oh, and here we see a good payoff card for the wild deck. There's actually 2. So we see a Raging T-Rex, which is a big champion that draws you extra cards. And another card that I'm sure Sam might be interested in, but, you know, is choosing not to pick over the Raging T-Rex, the Skaros, the card from Epic Uprising with a Loyalty X ability.
I'm curious to see if the other players in the cube draft are also valuing wild as much as Sam is, because without the loyalty, without the high investment in that color, Skaros isn't a very high pick like Raging T-Rex is.
So we could very well see if the other drafters are not as heavily in wild that this Skaros might even make it back to Sam, because it's definitely less impressive if you can only show 1 or 2 green wild cards. And here we see the next pack, not a lot of wild cards for Sam, but there is a Dracus Enforcer and another somewhat aggressive champion in Bellowing Minotaur. It looks like Sam's going for the Dracus Enforcer, an airborne champion, airborne being a specifically useful ability in aggressive decks to try and fly over blockers.
I mean, I think I'm really liking this deck so far. If, you know, you play a Dracus Enforcer on your opponent's turn, say it's the first turn of the game, now you're up to 6 cards, and you can swing that Dracus Enforcer in and start putting pressure on them. It's just a lot of... it forces your opponent to react, or they take 7 damage, and you can pass without spending your gold, or even play something extra that also draws you cards and is a threat, like Raging T-Rex or Triceratops.
Yeah, I think, and there we see that surprise attack we talked about earlier. And like Dracus Enforcer said, or like you said about Dracus Enforcer, it's a great way to establish something on the board on your opponent's turn while drawing a card. So not actually going down a card if your opponent removes it. I think that's very strong. Let me see here, Sam really thinking about that free removal spell in Spike Trap and that surprise attack. One of the things that's to note in Cube Draft is that the cards with a white symbol, like Spike Trap, you might see more often because they are common. There's three of them in the cube, whereas the surprise attack, there is only one of, because it has the red symbol for a special gem. That's how we built the cube. There's one of each card with a red gem, and three of each card with a white gem.
I really do like the pick of the Spike Trap there. I think surprise attack, you know, a lot of people might look at that and say, oh, I'm already in that alignment, and that means I need to take that card, or I have a lot of champions, so this must be good in my deck. But the looking at just some of the cards that we've already seen, you know, your opponent plays an Angel of Death, they swing in with it, and then you Spike Trap that. You know, where do they go from that? And they're put way behind. And we've also seen other cards that could potentially swing in and get removed by the Spike Trap, like Corpse Monger, Guild Demon, and Billowing Minotaur.
Yeah, and obviously having already a Jungle Queen might make it easier to swallow not picking that surprise attack. So in the next pack, what do we have here? We have a Gladius the Defender and a Hunting Pack. A Hunting Pack, a card from the new Uprising set, putting a bunch of wolves into play and then dealing damage equal to the offense of those wolves to a champion, gives you a way to both remove a champion from play and get a bunch of attackers. I think a good complement to Sam's deck so far.
It'll be interesting if he ever gets any synergy with some of the other wolf cards. You know, he has the Wolf Companion in his deck. If the opponent plays a... If he can get that wolf token and then utilize that to Hunting Pack, something that's bigger than 6 health, then his opponent is really going to be far behind. You don't expect, you know, 8 damage, make 3 wolf tokens ever.
Yeah. And so here we see Sam not picking a wild card, probably thinking, I have plenty of those, but what I don't have really is a gold cost removal, like unconditional, basically. So he picks up a Banishment, which banishes any champion, but the player whose turn it is draws a card. So this is something we see often in Epic, with cards that care about whose turn it is when you're using it. So Banishment, very good on your turn, because it draws you a card. Little less good on your opponent's turn, but that's generally when the removal is more powerful.
And I think, actually, if we go back to some of the cards that he's already picked, I really like the Banishment in this deck. In a lot of the slower decks, when you're trying to, you know, manage your opponent's threats and you don't have as many in your deck, Banishment isn't as powerful. You know, you really want to play it on your turn when you're ahead. And, you know, if he plays the Dracus Enforcer, or if he ambushes in a champion with Jungle Queen, and then his turn starts and he attacks, and his opponent plays a champion, and then 4 blocks, Banishment.
Yeah, that puts a lot of pressure on the opponent. And indeed, he has a lot of flash champions so far. Ambush champions, sorry. Oh, I've played so much Magic the Gathering back in the day that, you know, this is a hard habit to break. But ambush champions, meaning the champions that can be played on the opponent's turn. So here we're seeing Sam trying to decide, and he picks up a Time Walker, which is a very big champion. But it does have a Loyalty 2 effect. Do you think this means that Sam's going to be looking at trying to pick up more Sage card? Or maybe just a big attacker?
I mean, honestly, I think he's going to try and pull that off. If we look at some of the other cards that he's picked, the only other Sage cards he's picked so far are Force Mage Apprentice and Spike Trap. So if he can pull together some more Sage cards, then that'll complement the Force Mage Apprentice and the Time Walker. So I think taking this here is sort of it's a direction that he's putting the deck in, but also it's a bit of a risk.
All right, so we are most of the way through the second pack. We see here another free blitz champion coming in, and then a dark assassin. I doubt that one's making his deck, apart with a heavy loyalty requirement to evil, which he has just the corpse monger. Yeah, so in the cube draft, the players are drafting 36 cards total, and they'll be making some cuts. They'll cut down to 30 cards, so Sam definitely has a chance of, you know, not playing that that Dark Assassin if he doesn't want to. And I guess we missed a transform and a lying in wait in Sage, so he does have some more removal there in the Sage.
As well as the Keeper of Secrets. So I think that this kind of pushes his deck into the Sage and Wild territory. It looks like, just from looking through his pool, he's probably going to try and play some of the cards that are just powerful no matter what alignment you're playing. Like Ceasefire and Quell, I think, will both be quite good in his deck if he manages to land zero-cost champions. Like, he plays the Hunting Pack, and then he can, on his turn, banish all of his opponent's champions, and he gets to keep all of his wolves out on the table. Whenever you can clear your opponent's board and keep champions for yourself, it's a good sign that you're ahead.
Yeah, and I like the combination of the many free champions, especially a couple of champions that are free and have blitz, like the Corpsemonger and the Keeper of Secrets. If you manage to attack with those, then play a Time Walker, returning them to your hand and manage to attack again, that's a lot of value and a lot of pressure that you're putting up on your opponent.
Absolutely. One thing he is going to have to look out for is that early Flash Fire that he didn't pick. If he makes a bunch of tokens that have 2 health and his opponent follows up with a Flash Fire, then he is not going to be ahead in that value game.
Yeah, and so we're waiting here a second just to start the third pack, making sure we're staying on track with the whole tournament, and we see the players get ready for their first pick of the third pack. A little bit of an overview. We see Kyle Coons there with his epic shirt. And we have a bunch of actual real good players in this draft. We have Anthony Lowry, also known from the Magic community. Paul Reitzel, another Magic professional. Michael Majors, one as well. We have the first LCQ winner in this pod, Ben Sullivan. And then we have Hampus Eriksson and Nicholas Cuenca, which are very active in the Epic community, especially on Facebook and other social media. So looking at the first pick, once again, a Mistguide Herald. Sam considered picking that early in the first pack. I wonder if he's going to pick that now, but it's up against some strong competition.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Erase really goes well with his deck, just because he doesn't have a lot of removal for his opponent's champions on his opponent's turn. We saw that Lying in Wait, we saw the Transform, but he doesn't really want to use Banishment, and Erase gives him some way to do that and stock back up on cards. And card draw is something that you always want in a deck.
Yeah, and it's a very good way to, help his loyalty requirements for that Time Walker we saw earlier. And here we see another way to draw 2 cards, an Ancient Chant. We saw that being used to good effect on stream yesterday in Constructed, when one of our LCQ finals, the Sage Wild Tempo deck, which is kind of what Sam Black is drafting here, was using a lot of recycle cards to refill after an Ancient Chant, using Ancient Chant to draw 2, then recycling it out of the discard pile, drawing an extra card off of the recycle. And that's seems to be indeed what we're going with here.
I think another thing that he has to think about is he has a lot of loyalty 2 cards in his deck. He has that Strafing Dragon, he has that Raging T-Rex, he has the Dracus Enforcer, he has the Time Walker. And managing all of those things, do I pick the more powerful card or do I pick the card that's almost just as powerful, but, in my deck, I need that extra loyalty. I need that investment for Force Mage Apprentice, for...
So, what we see here is Sam picking, he's quickly moved a Strafing Dragon to the front, but he picked another cheap removal spell, the Lightning Strike, which cost zero. Picking that over the Strafing Dragon, which I'm sure he would have been happy to pick up as well. I guess he really does value that zero cost removal here.
Yeah, I mean, that Lightning Strike is the second card in a zero cost card in his deck that deals 5 damage now with the Spike Trap. So I think that if he comes up against an opponent with champions that don't have a lot of health but cost a gold, he can very easily get ahead there.
Yeah, and I like this pick from Sam again as well. Another wild champion that you can play on the opponent's turn, the Hunting Raptors. Not a super big champion by itself, but the ability to expend and deal 4 damage to either the opponent's champions or directly to the opponent's face. Good way to close out games as well as keep the board under control.
Yeah, one thing that we do see in this deck, even if he doesn't have the card draw in order to pull it together, he does have a couple cards that he can return from his discard pile. You know, if he doesn't have a play that he can make, he can pull back the Wolf Companion if he has in his discard pile. And I think that a big thing about this deck is that he doesn't appear to have any banish your opponent's discard pile in his hand, in his pool right now. So if he gets into a position where his opponent can, recycle that Lightning Storm we saw earlier or that Psionic Assault we saw earlier, then his only way out is going to be by drawing that Keeper of Secrets.
Yeah, and Lightning Storm and Psionic Assault, both cards that have the recall ability. Very useful, obviously, to stay in a game even when you're running out of cards. So here we see Sam decide between a Pack Alpha and a Temporal Enforcer. Two champions in his colors in the Wild and Sage faction. Both smaller champions that try to get some extra value either through loyalty or through putting some more tokens into play. Sam's going with the Pack Alpha. I guess possibly a good combo with that hunting pack he had earlier.
Yeah, I definitely think, if you have a hunting pack and you have a Pack Alpha, then your business. You make 2 wolves, your opponent's turn happens, you play hunting pack, and, oh, sorry, your Triceratops is dead. My turn starts, I'm going to attack you with my 5/3/3s.
Oh, yeah, that's a lot of damage coming in. And we see him, Sam followed up with another Rage, so another free pump spell. I think the second Rage, possibly even better than the first.
Yeah, I mean, having that extra Rage, the first Rage, your opponent is sort of playing around a little bit. They've seen at least one Rage in the draft, but if you've played a Rage, then they can kind of calm a little bit. You know, there aren't very many zero-cost cards that give Breakthrough, and if you attack with something else, and then suddenly you have that second Rage, then
it could lead to some huge blowouts. Especially, on some of the bigger champions Sam has, a Raging T-Rex, if you try to defend against that with just a human token or something, trying to, just stave off a bunch of damage, Rage could really come in to deal a bunch of damage. So here we see a card I think Sam is very happy to pick up, the Shadow Imp.
Oh, yeah.
A free champion that can attack immediately when it hits the field. It's unblockable, and it has an ally ability that lets you return it back to your hand to once again swing whenever you play another card of the same faction.
Yeah, and again, he's taken a lot of the removal for zero, so I think that his opponents will have a hard time getting rid of his Shadow Imp if, he's been holding all the Spike Traps and the Lightning Strikes and all of those sorts of things.
So here we see a very late Necrovirus going around the table, and a Saren, so evil might be less popular on this table.
Yeah, well, I mean, that Saren, if he does choose to play it, will be one of his few Blitz champions. It's a great way to punish an opponent if his opponent plays something on his turn, and then he wants to follow up that play by punishing them and dropping down a threat that just deals 7 deals 10 damage and is very hard to block, especially with that Rage. You know, if he plays that and attacks and the opponent blocks and he gives it Breakthrough and extra damage, then there's not much that his opponent can do.
I am Jay Lansdaal, and next to me is CJ Moynihan, and we'll be giving you coverage of the first round of the Epic World Championship. This is Cube Draft, and we are following for the first round. We have Sam Black versus Kyle Coons. So Sam Black, a notable Magic the Gathering professional, and Kyle Coons are notable Gen Con and other convention volunteers. And we have Kyle Coons on the right, it looks like, and Sam Black on the left. We also have a secondary feature match of Paul Reitzel versus Benjamin Sullivan. Benjamin Sullivan, the first person to actually qualify for the World Championship this year. He qualified in Austin, Texas at our South by Southwest convention. And I know you and I have some good memories of that event.
It was definitely an interesting event.
Yep, lots of kimchi fries, I remember.
Oh, yeah. They keep going back for more of those.
I don't think we skipped a single day where we could eat kimchi fries.
Every day we kept getting on that kimchi fries bandwagon.
Yeah, and there we see Kyle Coons staring into the distance.
He's ready. He's got his cards drawn.
Yeah, he's looking ready, and we're just waiting for the go-ahead from our team to start playing. It's obviously a lot going into these kind of streams. Players have to be seated. We need to have the table judge there. Somebody needs to give the go ahead, and it looks like we're ready to go play. So Sam Black, Kyle Coons, here we go. First round of the Epic World Championship, trying to win that 25k. So what would you be buying if you won a 25k today?
I mean, you can never have enough Epic.
I mean, but Epic is so cheap that wouldn't get you very far. So like, how what else? New car maybe?
Oh yeah, I think, yeah, I would definitely get a new car.
Definitely get a new car. All right. If you have any great ideas on how you would spend that 25K, let us know in the Twitch chat or on Twitter, at Epic Card Game, or at Star Realms or at Hero Realms Game, if you're so inclined. But on to the match. It's looking like Sam Black is taking a mulligan. He's choosing to mulligan three cards, which would cost him three health, which is why he's down to 27. He put those three cards on the bottom of his deck and drew three new cards. So what are some of the reasons why you would mulligan in a limited format?
Well, I mean, we followed Sam Black's draft, actually, a bit earlier, and having cards that have recycle that you can't play early on in the game, or you know, sometimes you just want a card, a couple options for your opponent's turn if you're going second, whether that's, you know, some combination of removal and the ability to draw cards, or you just want to hit your key loyalties. You know, if I had like a Raging T-Rex and one green card in my starting hand, I think I would definitely mulligan the other three.
Yeah, and so here we see Kyle start. He was happy with his hand, but he starts with an Ice Drake, which normally is a champion that you would use to expend your opponent's team. I'm a little surprised he chose not to mulligan and then played that without revealing anything on the first turn, not really showing anything going on. And Sam is going to counter with a Draka's Enforcer, showing a Hunting Raptors and a Strafing Dragon to draw a card off of it, putting a nice Airborne Defender on the board there. It's a 7-7 versus a 6-8, so those guys can hug it out to the end of times.
I think the Ice Drake actually says a lot about Kyle's hand. The fact that he didn't mulligan and he played the Ice Drake first means that the cards that he has ready for his opponent are likely ones that he wants to save for when his opponent has threats on the board.
Yeah, so likely some sort of removal spells I could see. Like if indeed you start with a threat on your opponent's turn, just to get something down to like start attacking. And maybe, because it looks like Sam Black might have even just passed with his gold up on his very first turn, leading to Kyle playing that Ice Drake and then Sam Black responding with a nice Airborne Defender, and while Kyle might have like smelled some weakness and thought, I'm going to just put this Ice Drake out there now, not saving it for later to tap down his team, just to try to get some damage in, but that seemingly backfired.
Yes, I think Kyle definitely got punished there. If he had chosen to draw for his turn instead, he would have the initiative and the gold, and he could save the Ice Drake for when it'd be relevant.
Yeah.
Especially if we start to see a lot of champions in Sam Black's side later in the game.
So we see here Ice Drake coming in, and Sam indeed defending with that Draka's Enforcer. And yeah, the six attack, the six offense go into the seven defense, and the seven offense of the Draka's Enforcer go into the eight defense of the Ice Drake. Both champions will survive, and Kyle's now looking to play a Strafing Dragon. And let's see what he reveals for loyalty. He's showing a Mighty Blow and a Hurricane. That he uses that to finish off the Draka's Enforcer. And there's a quick little judge call, it looks like. There's some confusion about the timing of things here. So we're trying to work that out. So it's looking like Kyle is planning to play the Strafing Dragon to get rid of the, try to finish off that Draka's Enforcer that was in the way of his Ice Drake. And yeah, here we see the judge resolving this. As always, when you're playing at your local tournaments, if there's ever a misunderstanding, call a judge, because they can help you figure out what is going on and what is the most appropriate fix for situations where, you know, there was a misunderstanding or there is something that went wrong. It might not be anybody's fault, you know, things happen, but judges are always there to help you out. So keep that in mind. Always call a judge if anything ever happens. So it's looking like we're going back to the play, because Sam is staring at the board.
I think Sam was considering playing something during combat. So you know, the Ice Drake attacked, the Draka's Enforcer blocked, and then before damage, Sam was thinking about doing something. And Kyle was, you know, thinking, oh...
Assuming, I want to do something, and took his initiative, possibly when his opponent was considering still his, you know, what he would do with his initiative. So we'll see how that continues from here on out.
You know, we saw some of the cards that Sam drafted earlier. If he has, say, a Wolf Companion, this would be a perfect time to play it.
Or his own Strafing Dragon. So before we go to damage, Sam is going to play his Strafing Dragon, deal 5 damage to the Ice Drake, and then use a Spike Trap to finish it off. So using that free spell on top of his gold to get rid of Kyle's attacker, making Kyle's intended play of playing a Strafing Dragon now kind of pointless, because the Ice Drake did not actually deal any damage to the Draka's Enforcer yet, because we were not that far in the combat yet. And now Sam in a commanding position with two giant dragons on the field, and Kyle currently with nothing on the board.
I think it's definitely interesting that he chose to block with the Draka's Enforcer first. I think he was seeing if he could bait out some kind of pump from Kyle, like a Rage or a Wolf's Companion.
Yeah, and Kyle choosing to spend his gold to get rid of both of those champions that Sam put on the field. He uses a Hurricane, which Big Storm deals 9 damage to all champions, and both Strafing Dragon and Draka's Enforcer will not survive that. And he follows up with a zero-cost champion, the Guilt Demon. He uses it to banish the Spike Trap, putting it from the discard pile on the bottom of the deck, and now attacking with it. And let's see if he gets another trigger out of that, and he banishes the Draka's Enforcer.
Definitely think that the decision to play the Guilt Demon here is pretty interesting. You know, it starts to put some pressure on your opponent, but he could also choose to save it for when his opponent has a effect in the discard pile that he really wants to get rid of.
Yeah, obviously by putting the Guilt Demon on the field, you're exposing it to all kinds of removal spells, or something like this, a Force Mage Apprentice coming in with Blitz, immediately dealing 2 damage to that Guilt Demon. And now, yeah, you've banished a Spike Trap and a Draka's Enforcer, but none of those cards were really doing anything in that discard pile.
Yeah, I mean, he's put his opponent off the recycle, but I think that he got punished pretty hard for it.
Yeah. Sam choosing to spend his gold to load up on some more cards, preparing his Force Mace Apprentice so that it can shoot again, or, you know, possibly wait for Kyle to put some extra champions into play and maybe shoot those if they're small enough. And maybe just the threat of it might, you know, prevent Kyle from playing some of the smaller champions.
Yeah, I definitely think that as far as options go, just having the... drawing the two on his turn, you know, he could have passed without playing anything, but he knows that his opponent is in a weak position here, and if he loads up on cards and just maintains his lead of, you know, a lot of more cards in hand, one more card on the board, then Kyle's going to have to get back into this game with a lot of miracles.
Yep. So here we see Kyle, empty board, but, you know, it's still early in the game. He's at 28 health, and he's got a grip full of cards after reloading with that mighty blow, drawing a card for his turn. And let's see what he's playing here. Ah, unbreakable vampire, the Vampire Lord, a 5/5 that has blitz, and whenever it deals damage, it becomes bigger.
Kind of ironic that Sam just used that lying in wait.
Yeah, lying in wait would be a good answer to this vampire. Basically, because the vampire is unbreakable on Kyle's turn, a lying in wait that would banish it would get around that. So Sam here choosing to get aggressive. He plays a hunting raptor, chose a fire shaman and a jungle queen, to give it blitz and immediately using the expend power to deal 4 damage to Kyle.
You know, I think if Sam chooses to be very greedy here, he can finish off that
the vampire
the vampire by playing the fire shaman, finishing it off with the fire shaman and playing more cards.
Yeah. But
what it does do is it leaves him very open to any kind of effect that clears the board.
Yeah.
We did already see Kyle use the hurricane, so, you know, depending on what else is in his deck, he could have other board clears, and I think that's exactly what he's going to need.
Yeah, because obviously in a draft, it's less reliable on, you know, whether you see a bunch of board clears in your draft, whether you get to draft them. Other people might be picking them very highly as well. So I think Sam thinks it's pretty safe here. Plays the Fire Shaman, the Jungle Queen, uses his trigger ability from the Fire Shaman and the Hunting Raptor to get rid of that vampire, and then uses a Force Mage Apprentice to attack Kyle's health total once again. It's looking like we're going to need an update on that one sometime soon. And Kyle, yeah, using a second Mighty Blow here to draw some more cards. Mighty Blow is a pretty interesting card. Is that something you would you'd be hoping to pick up multiples of in your draft?
Well, I mean, Mighty Blow is a very all-in kind of card. You know, if you're attacking with a champion, you Mighty Blow it, and that could be 10 damage to your opponent. But if your opponent has a good answer, you know, we saw the haste retreat in the draft. If you Mighty Blow something when your opponent hasn't spent their gold and they haste retreat it, then you spent your gold, card, whatever you're attacking with, and they didn't spend anything, and you don't deal any of that damage.
Yeah, so looks like a very risky play. So maybe Kyle is figuring, hey, you know, I want to get first today. And I'm not going to do that without, you know, getting some lucky breaks here and there, possibly trying to push his luck or the inexperience of people. You know, people might not defend against something, not expecting a mighty blow. And then, you know, it could actually be quite a mighty blow to the head if you suddenly take 10 that you weren't expecting.
Yeah, you know, I think one of the things with a mighty blow is definitely a lot better when your opponent doesn't know that you have it. And Sam could take note of the fact that Kyle's already played 2 this game and prepare for that in later games.
Yeah, we see Kyle thinking quite long and hard here, trying to figure out a way to get back into the game. He starts it by playing a Wolf's Bite, which bites the Force Mage Apprentice, breaking it, putting it into the discard pile, and getting a Wolf himself. And he's now deciding which 2 cards to recycle. He's going to put 2 cards on the bottom of his deck, choosing to recycle the Hurricane, which to me signals that he might not have anything like a Lesson Learned or a Memory Spirit or something to get that back out of the discard pile.
Absolutely, especially from this position, that it will be the kind of thing that he wants. He was also thinking pretty hard about whether he wanted to get rid of the Fire Shaman or the Force Mage Apprentice there.
Yeah.
And the Fire Shaman has a potential for more damage. But, you know, you really have to have all those wild cards. So maybe Kyle is hoping, hey, if Sam Beck doesn't have a good wild card right here, then, you know, I don't have to worry too much about that Fire Shaman if it's not dealing damage every turn like the Force Mage Apprentice is. But
yeah, because obviously against a Force Mage Apprentice, if you end up breaking the Fire Shaman, and leave the Forge Mage Apprentice. That Forge Mage Apprentice is going to be more than happy to take care of that wolf token over there without anything else. But Sam looks to be loading up. He uses a Seize Fire to draw two cards. Loading up his hand again. Probably, you know, sticking it full of more wild cards, because as we saw in the draft, he has a lot of them.
Absolutely. And, you know, the Fire Shaman actually does 4 damage when it attacks due to the fact that it has the boost from the Jungle Queen on it.
That's so right. Jungle Queen pumping Sam's team, and he starts off the turn by using his Hunter and Grafters to deal 4 damage to the Fire Spirit on Kyle's side, and using another free spell, the Lightning Strike, to finish it off. And that, I think this really shows the power of the free spells that help you remove champions, because now Sam Black is attacking with a pretty sizable champion, the Jungle Queen, but he still has his gold up, despite having just removed one of Kyle's defenders. So he's putting the onus on Kyle to try and replace that Fire Spirit with something that can defend his life total, while risking, you know, some blowback from Sam, who still has his gold up.
You know, if Kyle doesn't block this, or if it does, and doesn't spend his gold, I think I really like the play of just not passing without spending your gold.
And it looks like it looked for a second there, Sam was taking back his champion. Kyle might have not been ready or waiting, thinking of maybe he had some chance to respond. But that's the thing in Epic, you cannot respond to your opponent's plays if they have initiative. Initiative kind of works like a talking stick. If you have it, your opponent cannot interrupt you, and you'll have to wait for them to pass it. And when do they do that? Well, when they want to move to a new phase. So if Sam Black attacks, he wants to go to the blockers part, because he wants to get eventually to damage. To be able to go to blockers, he'll have to pass initiative to Kyle. Who then gets a chance to do something, and in this case, Kyle does do something. He puts a Strafing Dragon on the board, showing a Chomp and a Wolf's Companion, dealing damage to the Fire Shaman, and he's now considering going to blocks, but before he can do that, he has to pass initiative to Sam. Sam gets a chance to respond before we actually move to blockers, because both players have to pass initiative, you know, move around the talking stick until both players have had it, and then we move to the actual blocking. After that, we do the same thing. Both players get a chance to have initiative. If two players pass consecutively, we go to damage, and so on and so forth until, you know, we move to the next turn.
And, you know, Kyle has that backup Wolf's Companion here, so I think he's actually pretty safe. Now, what he's thinking about is, does he double block? You know, double blocking is a little greedy. If he double blocks, the wolf dies, and he is a little vulnerable to a big Blitz champion. But it means that he doesn't have to spend his Wolf's Companion. And even if his opponent has, you know, good removal for his wolf, then he can buff up the Strafing Dragon and kill it.
Yeah, and here we see one of those rages we saw Sam Black draft to really put the pressure on Kyle here. He's making his Jungle Queen big enough to take down both of Kyle's champions. And let's see, so the Strafing Dragon is a 6 offense attacker. The Wolf champion adds 2, putting it at 8 offense, which now with the rage on top of the Jungle Queen would not be... Jungle Queen is now big enough to survive the damage from the opposing champions.
And also the Wolf's Companion isn't even enough to buff it up. You know, he could choose to save one of his champions by Wolf's by using the Wolf Companion on one. You know, the wolf will survive. But if even if he does, you know, the combined attack of both of his champions will be 10, which isn't enough to finish off that Jungle Queen.
Yeah, and Sam did this once again with a free spell. So even if, you know, Kyle spends all these resources to keep one of his champions alive, Sam still has the option of playing a big Blitz attacker or anything else, reloading his hand with a bunch of extra cards. And yeah, we see Kyle choosing not to use the Wolf's Companion and taking a couple points of damage even from that rage, it looks like.
Yeah, he took one off the Jungle Queen is 9, and so with the combined defense of 8, the breakthrough lets him deal one damage.
Yeah, and another free spell for Sam. He's keeping the pressure up with those free spells. Puts a Keeper of Secrets in play, and then uses a Transform to refill his hand. So one of the disadvantages of playing a bunch of free spells is obviously you deplete your hand pretty quickly. But Sam is managing to really keep his hand stocked while pumping out these free spells at every possible opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, playing that Keeper of Secrets and then the Transform as a draw 2, it's a function like a draw 3. And it's really a valuable champion as long as Kyle can't get rid of that every time he plays a Sage 1 cost card. He's going to draw that extra card, and you know, from what we've seen in his discard pile, he has plenty of cards to recycle, so he is not going to run out of discard pile anytime soon.
Yeah, and we see Sam considering for a second there whether he wants to attack or maybe banish a card from Kyle's discard pile. Kyle doesn't really have much to respond with yet because he spent his gold already. Sam does not consider it safe to attack with the Keeper of Secrets, and he uses it instead to banish a card out of Kyle's discard pile. We now move over to Kyle's turn. Sam has done a lot of work that turn.
Oh yeah, I mean, even with his Fire Shaman dying, he managed to play another zero cost champion, draw 3 cards, and use a zero cost card to clear both Kyle's gold, his remaining token, and deal damage to him.
Yeah, so once again, we're looking at a board where Sam Black is definitely in a dominant position, having 3 champions out, 2 of which are gold champions, so fairly sizable threats. With Kyle not having anything, surely he's hoping he has a second Hurricane or something in his draft deck. He starts off with a pretty good way to get back on the board, though. He has a Palace Guard, which is a champion that when it enters, comes into play, it has a tribute ability. Tribute meaning the champion that you play pays tribute to you by giving you some sort of effect. And in this case, the effect was, I am going to banish a champion. The Hunting Raptors went to the bottom of Sam's deck.
Now he's playing the Erase, and he has to return a champion to his owner's hand. But I actually like this. It looks like he's looking to return the Keeper back to his hand. And what that means is, you know, he could have chose to return his opponent's card back to his hand. That's the really obvious play. But he doesn't want his opponent to have the opportunity to banish his champion again. And, you know, knowing that Kyle is running lower on cards, not returning a champion back to his hand means he's going to have to spend a turn drawing cards, or he's going to have to play a lot of card draw.
Yep, and we'll see here, so Sam played an Erase with a Keeper of Secrets in play, targeting the Keeper of Secrets. The Keeper of Secrets has an ally ability, letting him recycle 2 cards, and there was a quick question there, I think, to the judge, like, hey, can I recycle this Erase? And indeed, you can. By the time that the Erase, you know, the Erase you play first, you resolve, do everything that the Erase can do, and then you try to resolve the recycle ability. At that point, the Erase is in the discard pile and is a valid target for the recycle ability. And here we see Sam with another free champion, really putting the pressure on a Shadow Imp, which is a Blitz attacker that's unblockable, so there was no chance for Kyle to defend with his Palace Guard there. And then playing the Keeper of Secrets and another blue card. This is one from the new set. He banishes Kyle's entire discard pile and draws 2 cards, triggering the Shadow Imp, returning it back to Sam's hand, giving him a chance to attack again, and the Keeper of Secrets to once again recycle, really keeping his hand fully stocked.
The Keeper of Secrets has done a lot of work. You know, it's a zero-cost champion. He's recycled 3 times off of it, and it's also banished a card from his opponent's discard pile.
Yeah, and it let him play that Erase, because otherwise, you know, returning back that Palace Guard, not be very good, nor would returning his own Jungle Queen. And here we see that Shadow Imp doing what it does best, striking from the shadows, fluttering in and out of existence just to hunt you with that little shining knife there. Now, personally, I think if you're, you know, trying to live in the shadows, would you bring a shining knife?
I mean, if I'm already there, then, you know, my opponents aren't going to expect me to be having a knife.
See, I think Shadow Imp might just be having a hard time with his vision. So he might have had the light, you know, to actually find his target, so that he knows when he's stabbing something. Oh yeah, that's actually what I'm supposed to be stabbing.
Yeah, that must be why he went over to the sage side, you know.
Trying to find some wisdom, hoping that eventually they'll invent glasses. So we saw Kyle play a chomp there on the Jungle Queen, which has so basically it trades one for one, but it prevents Sam from using the Jungle Queen to play wild champions out of his hand, surprising Kyle with some wild champions that, you know, may or may not be played on the opponent's turn. And now Kyle is actually getting frisky. He's attacking with a Palace Guard.
Wow.
So Sam is responding with a Battle Cry, which lets him draw two cards and makes his champions a little bit bigger. So they get three offense, three defense, breakthrough, which is not going to matter on defense. But he does get to draw two. And he's putting his Keeper of Secrets in front of the Palace Guard. Palace Guard is a 6/8. And the Keeper of Secrets with three extra offensive defense won't be big enough to take it down. But Sam's showing that second rage here, pumping his Keeper of Secrets to bigger than the Palace Guard.
I mean, that Keeper of Secrets is really pumping the iron, huh?
Yeah, they are going for it. And he's going to use it to also expend, he's going to expend it to banish the chomps. We're not there yet. It looks like Sam passed initiative, so Kyle is now considering if he wants to do something. So we're waiting for a second to see what Kyle wants to do here. See if he has some sort of trick to save his Palace Guard. We saw he has a bunch of Mighty Blows earlier, so he might, you know, be valuing pump spells a lot. Maybe he has something else he wants to do.
It's true, but if he uses the Mighty Blow here, then he's spending a gold to kill his opponent's zero-cost champion.
Yeah, that does not sound like a great idea. So let's see what we're doing here.
You know, that is the second rage that we saw played from Sam, and the second chomp that we've seen played from Kyle.
Yep.
I think that, you know, that kind of brings back into the whole cube aspect we were talking about earlier. If your opponent plays a card in cube, that doesn't necessarily mean that
there's not a second one.
Right.
And so here indeed we saw Kyle spend his gold to get rid of a zero cost champion. Generally not a play, you know, that's very good for you. But in this case it seems to have worked out at least somewhat. The board is fairly stabilized. Kyle's a little lower on health. And he has a lot less cards in his hand than Sam actually does. Sam constantly recycling and drawing extra cards. And Kyle, we can see a little bit from his body language. I think he's a little worried about this game.
Yeah, I think that Kyle realizes that past turn that the Keeper of Secrets was so vital to Sam's plays, just having it out. Drawing three cards, here he would have drawn another card. Even spending a gold to get rid of it, I mean,
might have been worth it, but now we see Sam really taking advantage of the fact that Kyle doesn't have a lot of cards in hand. He's playing a Psionic Assault, the card that lets you, that makes your opponent discard two cards at the end of their turn, returning a Shadow Imp to his hand, and then passing initiative to Kyle, who is going to play an Ice Drake. Once again, not getting full value out of that Ice Drake because Sam doesn't have any champions to expend.
That's right.
Now, after that Ice Drake comes in, Sam's going to play a Shadow Imp, sort of rebuilding his board a little bit. And we're going to see because Kyle is now, I think, down to three cards, so he's going to have one card by the end of this turn.
Yes, and Sam here is recognizing that even though the Shadow Imp has that unblockable, he doesn't have to attack with it. You know, that Palace card comes in, he can block with the Shadow Imp, and then maybe use a Sage card to get rid of the Ice Drake while returning his Shadow Imp to safety.
Yeah, and because the Palace card would be considered defended against, so it would not deal any damage unless it somehow managed to get breakthrough.
It's a good thing that Kyle recognized this, and he's attacking with the Ice Drake first.
Because,
you know, say that Sam has a Transform in his hand, you know, his opponent attacks the palace guard, he blocks, transforms to ice rake, then, you know, Kyle's put in a really awkward position.
Yeah. Yeah, Kyle showing it's likely not his first rodeo here. Putting his best foot forward, attacking with the ice rake first.
Even with all the card advantage, you know, Sam drawing a lot of cards, Kyle discarding cards, he still manages to get ahead in life totals.
Yeah, he just, Sam just took the 6 damage from the ice rake, going down to 13 damage. And yeah, like we said, despite Kyle being down on resources, he currently has a commanding lead on the board. And we'll see what Sam's going to do to try and rectify that. So he plays his second hunting raptor, showing a raging T-Rex and a flame spirit, giving the hunting raptor's blitz. So now he can use that to deal 4 damage. I'm interested to see what he does here. So 4 damage could go to a player as well. So he could put Kyle down to 11, which puts him within somewhat of striking distance of a bunch of burn spells. We didn't see Sam draft too many of those, but we might have missed a couple here and there.
Yeah, I definitely think that having that Hunting Raptors there is an interesting play, because if he uses the Hunting Raptors to deal damage to Kyle at the end of Kyle's turn, and then Kyle attacks with his champion, that puts and Sam decides not to block with his zero cost champion, that actually puts Sam all the way down to 7.
Yeah, and this has been a fairly interesting game. It's been going so back and forth that we're about halfway into the round at this point. So somebody's gotta be starting making some moves here, otherwise you might run the risk of not being able to finish your second match and just losing to that first game you lost.
Yes, and I think if you look at the board here, I mean, this game could definitely end very quickly if Sam decides to take that damage and then he has Kyle has some kind of trick to deal 7 damage. You know, we have, there's the in the format, there's Fires of Rebellion and the Flame Strike. So, you know, either of those could finish Sam off if he's if he gets all the way down to 7 health.
Yeah, and Kyle is really trying to put this game away now, playing his unbreakable vampire, the Vampire Lord, his second of this draft as well, trying to put the pressure on Sam, trying to see if he can take advantage of the fact that Sam took a bunch of damage off that ice drake and that he spent his gold already. So Sam considering to defend, and it looks like he's throwing the Shadow Imp under the bus here, which will grow the Vampire Lord a little bit, putting it up to a 7 offense and 7 defense champion. Kyle, 1 card in hand.
And I'm really surprised that he decided not to attack the Palace Guard there. And that, Sam Black decided not to use the Hunting Raptors either, even after giving it Blitz.
Yeah, I wonder if he was just... you might have just either missed it, or I guess maybe if he uses it and he has to pass back initiative, he's afraid Kyle might do something even worse, so he was happy to take his turn. And
yeah. I mean, if he did attack with the Palace Guard, then Sam could block with the Hunting Raptors and then finish it off by using the expendability on the Palace Guard before the damage happened from blocks.
Yeah, so that's likely what he probably wasn't willing to trade his Hunting Raptors for the Palace Guard and was happy to take the turn here now that Kyle passed the initiative. And Sam using a Corpse Monger, not to attack in this case, but to banish the Draka's Enforcer in Kyle's discard pile, trying to buff his health total a little bit because that was getting precariously low.
And, we see Kyle here definitely realizing that that 3 health, I mean, that could really matter. At this point, he's running low on cards, his opponent has options, he has that Psionic Assault in the discard pile, he has the removal from the Fire Spirit to deal 4 damage to one of his champions, and if he can't get rid of that Corpse Monger, he's going to have to start building a board again.
Yeah, and that's a tough thing to do when you don't have a lot of cards in hand. So he chooses to get back his Wolf Companion, using the recall ability, which useful, puts an extra wolf into play, but it's not the high-powered play that we're looking for to try and break through Sam Black's board here. So once again, Kyle attacking with the Ice Drake first, and we'll see if Sam has a different response this time than just taking the 6 damage. Sam does have a handful of cards, and he's considering playing one now. Ooh, there we go. There's the Hunting Pack. That we saw earlier, putting 3 wolf tokens into play, then dealing damage equal to their offense to a champion. In this case, dealing 6, but because of the Fire Spirit, he can deal some extra damage, and he finishes off the Ice Drake while adding a bunch of champions to his board.
And I would definitely be worried if I was Kyle. I mean, staring down those wolves, he has enough blockers to block anything that comes his way. And, you know, if he attacks with everything and doesn't have any way to stop the damage coming in, then it's Sam's turn, you know, he has lethal on the board.
Yeah, it's getting pretty like precarious here, because the Hunting Raptor can still be used, possibly if Sam plays another wild card, which I think we know he has a couple still. He can use the Fire Spirit to deal some damage as well. And Kyle, yeah, deep in the tank, he's taken a lot of time this game trying to figure out if he can still win this. But yeah, it's you don't have that much time to win a second game, Kyle. So if that's the plan, then might want to consider packing this one up. But he's still fighting.
I mean, the Vampire Lord, which he's thinking about tracking with, both players know that he has the Wolf Companion, so I don't think that it is all that safe for him to attack, you know. His opponent isn't going to try and block with the Fire Spirit, since, you know, he knows that he has that +2/+2 buff, toss onto the Vampire Lord, and it's just going to kill off a wolf.
Yeah, and here we see indeed Sam Black getting aggressive with that Hunting Raptors, dealing damage directly to Kyle, probably looking to go in for the kill after Kyle spent his gold to basically cycle the Wave of Transformation to draw 2 cards. Wave of Transformation, normally an incredibly good mass removal spell that you can play on your opponent's turn, but in this case, yeah, you're taking away some champions, but Sam has a bunch of wolves, and just, you know, you're not really dealing with those by giving him just a bunch of more wolves.
I mean, yeah, we saw that yesterday. If you take a wolf, transforming it doesn't really do anything.
Nope, no. And here, we're starting to see some attacks coming in. Sam choosing to attack with, possibly choosing to attack with some wolves as a group.
Yeah, well, we know that he has the Fire Spirit and the Hunting Raptors up, so it's very likely that he can deal that extra 4 damage to one of his opponent's champions if he needs to.
Yeah, so indeed, combining 2 wolves would make it very difficult for Kyle to block. But instead, he chooses to attack with 1 for now, which at least deals with the Hunting Raptor, after Kyle plays the Entangling Vines, he uses that to deal with the Hunting Raptors, making it a little harder for Sam Black to push through this wolf.
I think if he can afford to do it, blocking with the Vampire Lord is actually quite good here. It gets the extra 2 counters on it.
Yeah. Vampire Lord does not care if it's attacking or defending. If it deals damage, it'll grow after. So managing to eat like a little champion here might be good for Kyle.
I think that was a very smart play, the way he expended his opponent's Hunting Raptors. Doing that prevents him from using the extra 4 damage.
Yeah, that could be the difference here. Like 4 damage to the face puts Kyle at a very low life total, well within range of further burn spells. It shaves a full turn off the clock, as we call it. Now Sam still has to have 3 activations of Hunting Raptors from this point onwards, whereas if he could have used it this turn, he would only have to use 2, because Kyle would go down to 7, which is within range of the 2 activations. So now Sam indeed attacking, now that the wolves have traded, with the 2 wolves, probably planning, or signifying to Kyle, hey, I have another wild card in my hand. If you block with one of those champions, I might have some effects here.
I definitely think that he has to go for the block with the Vampire Lord, though. If he takes the damage, It's a bit risky, but, you know, blocking with the Vampire Lord gets bigger, it's still out of the range of the damage from the Fire Spirit.
Yeah, unless Sam has an event that he could play that's wild, and he managed to do the damage to the Vampire Lord before damage is actually dealt, then we...
That's true, but we do know that he had the Wolf Companion.
Yeah, that's true. And here we see indeed a Wolf Companion being played, and then a defense with the Palace Guard. Probably thinking, well, now I'm sort of out of range, but Sam has his own wolf companion pumping his wolves to make them big enough to, if he combines it with the Fire Spirit, to get through that Palace Guard.
I think that the wolves companion are definitely favoring the wolves today.
Yeah, and Sam is heavy on wolves. There's a pack alpha, the biggest wolf in our game. Nope, not anymore, actually. We have a recent card, Den Mother, coming in, taking that title away. But still, I think the honorary, you know, pack alpha, putting a bunch of wolves in play, making them bigger. Yeah, it's going to be hard for Kyle. He really, he's been struggling from early on trying to find a sort of mass removal spell to deal with all of Sam's threats. And when he finally found one, the Wave of Transformation, he was kind of forced to use that to reload his hand a bit. And Sam seems to be taking full advantage of that by putting even more champions on the board while dealing with Kyle's.
Yeah, it looks like he was really planning on using that Entangling Vines, you know, to expanding one of his opponent's big champions and then hitting him in the face. That could possibly be a route to victory, or even just forcing your opponent to spend their gold to do something that they wouldn't want to do otherwise. But now, stopping one champion isn't going to be enough.
Yep, he's still attacking, though. There comes the Vampire Lord, and Sam's saying, yep, that's fine with me. I'll throw a wolf in front of it. I have plenty of those.
I think that the way that Kyle is acting, he probably has some kind of effect that that will clear the board here, or even just stop the damage for a turn. You know, that Vampire Lord, attacking with it makes sense. He needs to put some pressure on Sam, or he's just not going to be able to win this game. And
yeah, so indeed, either he might have some in hand still to stave off defeat next turn, or maybe this was a desperation move, and he's just trying to see what he can get done. Maybe Sam messes up. He's looking to attack now, possibly with his Entangling Vines. He must be either feeling very confident or not confident at all. It's coming in, and Sam is willing to trade his Fire Spirit here. See if Kyle has any kind of... Because I think at this point Sam is also not defending with his Wolf Champion, probably to play around some sort of breakthrough effect.
Yes, I think that, again, Sam is realizing that, well, I need to make sure that I don't die, because I'm pretty ahead in this game. I have the Course Monger in play. My opponent wants to wipe the board, then I'm not going to take any damage in the process.
Yep. And here we see Kyle once again deep in the tank, trying to figure out what can I do here to take this game from Sam. It's looking rough. Sam is too many... hands through the hair. What are we doing? Pointing at the oh my god, so many champions there that I'm having a hard time dealing with.
I mean, that Course Monger has gained him 9 health. That's almost an inner piece in and of itself.
Yeah, true. It's a lot of work from that free champion, and it seems like Sam's strategy of getting a bunch of those free champions and cards to draw cards is really paying off for him. Yeah, Kyle trying to make the best of it. Reading that pack alpha again. What did that card do again?
Yeah, so, you know, if he doesn't get rid of the pack alpha, then the Fire Spirit actually manages to kill the vines and survive.
Oh.
Because he gets the +1/+1 from the pack alpha.
That's right. The pack alpha is not discriminatory towards what kind of wolf you are. If you are a Fire Spirit, but, feeling like a wolf, then, hey, you got it. You get a little buff there. It's tough times here, and I'm trying to look at Kyle's draft deck that we have here, see what he could have.
So it looks like he had 2 flame strikes in his hand, and that means that, you know, had his opponent not had that Course Monger, then that double flame strike definitely would have changed the game a lot.
It's really looking like Kyle is playing a fairly high risk, high reward kind of strategy. Lots of big chunks of damage. We've seen the mighty blows. We've seen the double flame strike and double mighty blows we saw. Yeah. Then a bunch of ice strikes, trying to probably like tap down teams, get in for a bunch of damage, mighty blowing possibly, and just like wiping people down from a very high life total. Probably hoping to capitalize on some, you know, some more loose blocking decisions because they don't expect a bunch of damage.
And I even think that at the beginning of the game, that early ice strike really changed things up. When he dropped the ice strike at the beginning of the game, and then his opponent, you know, played the Draka's Enforcer there and drew that card, that really put him in an awkward position where he started. He was already playing from behind, even from the beginning of the game.
Yeah, yeah, and against an aggressive deck like what Sam managed to draft, I think that's that matters quite a bit.
Maybe this game, if Sam is going first and he passes that spending his gold, Kyle will take this opportunity to draw a card instead of spending it on something that, you know, lets his opponent get ahead.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So Sam is doing a mulligan here. He's mulliganing two cards, going down to 28, and drawing two new cards, and some goodies there. And we'll see if Kyle chose to go first or if he chose to go second. But first, he has to makes mulligan decisions as well. It's looking like he's gonna banish two cards. Yep, there we go. 30 down to 28, and draw two cards. No, he made Sam start, and Sam starts by putting a bunch of cards on the board. Here's a pack alpha with some wolves. The card that basically put the nail in the coffin in the last game, now here from the start. And asking Kyle, hey, do you have an answer?
Yeah, I think this is actually a great play from Sam based on what we've seen. Kyle played last game. He has a lot of big champions, and not having any ways to break through those small champions or lots of smaller minions, when he attacks with a really big thing and his opponent can just toss a wolf in the way, really throws a wrench in his plans.
Yeah, and once again we see a wave of transformation paired off against a bunch of wolves tokens. Yeah, that wave of transformation looking a lot less impressive when the opponent just has a bunch of tokens that you're not really actually dealing with this wave. So Kyle uses it to draw two cards, giving him a lot of options on his turn, and seemingly already in the tank, trying to decide what to do. And Kyle, you know, this round, it's not untimed. Unlike the marathon match we had yesterday, if this turns into one of those marathon matches, it's gonna be a bad result. So we see a free removal spell, the Wither, getting rid of Sam Black's wolf tokens, and Kyle trying to take advantage by playing a Rampaging Worm, a giant 14-14 blitz champion, hoping to, you know, catch Sam off guard and taking away half his life total. But Sam was ready with an erase, and back on his turn he's playing two wolf champion, or using his pack alpha to create two more wolf champions, and once again passing this turn with his gold up.
And I think that Kyle is realizing again that you know, this game started the fact that the time is already gone down so much, he really needs to close this game out quickly if he's going to
try and win a third one.
Yeah. You know, if this game goes to time and neither player can win, then Kyle's going to lose just in that first game.
Yep. He's choosing to spend his goal to play an Army of the Apocalypse to draw two cards, and Sam choosing to do a similar thing, using his lying in wait to draw two cards. Kyle drawing for his turn, and yeah, Kyle, you gotta get on the board here.
So, you know, we know that Kyle has that Rampaging Worm, and as long as Sam has all these cards in play, that Rampaging Worm isn't going to be great, but, you know, maybe if he can land an Ice Drake on his opponent's turn at some point later in the game, that Rampaging Worm will be a lot better.
Yeah. And here we see Kyle choosing not really to get on the board, but trying to get Sam off of it. Playing a chomp to get rid of a pack alpha. Sam Black responding with the Hunting Raptors, using it to shoot Kyle in the face, 4 damage, going down from 28 to 24, and untapping with basically the same board, a 5 power attacker and 2 wolf tokens. And Sam is now ready to attack with these things. They finally stayed in play long enough to get some work done, and yeah, he's sending in the wolf token.
I believe that we actually revealed a hunting pack out of those two, so that's going to be even more brutal with these two wolf tokens.
Oh, wow, yeah, so that's a lot of wolves. And
he's going to go with the banishment here.
And like we discussed in the draft, it's really good when you can put your opponent under pressure. They try to defend with an ambush defender, and then you use the banishment. Hey, bye-bye, you spent your gold. I got a free card out of this. And possibly, you know, some damage for future things. Really good.
I think this all goes back to the fact that, you know, Kyle is, again, trying to play very risky. He is playing a lot of high-risk, high-reward plays, and he needs to play greedy if he's going to get back into this game. But
yeah, Sam seems to be ready. So here, yeah, Kyle, once again, trying to get something done, putting a Vampire Lord down and sending it in towards Sam. No fear, he's hoping to get back in that damage race, but Sam, using the other side of the Shadow Imp, playing it for free, jumping in front of the Vampire Lord, and then playing a one-cost card, returning that champion to his hand.
You know, it's actually really interesting. The Vampire Lord doesn't get any bigger.
Yeah, that's right. No, we said he doesn't care if he whether or not, you know, he's attacking or defending, but just about the damage. But there was no Shadow Imp to, you know, to drain some blood from, so he doesn't get stronger. Oh, man, and look at that, just that hand over there. So many cards, so many options. I wonder what Sam's going to do here. Like, the pressure is not on him, but he seems to be the guy pressuring the opponent.
Yeah, and we know that he has the Lightning Strike there for the Vampire Lord. Really, just whenever you can deal with a one-cost champion with a zero-cost.
Yeah, that worked out just perfectly. The Shadow Imp jumping in front, making sure the Vampire Lord did not get bigger, and then dealing with it with a Lightning Strike. Two zero cards combining to basically just get rid of Kyle's entire gold play. Very impressive. And once again, choosing not to attack with the Hunting Raptor, not exposing it to any ambush champions, just going straight for the face, and then attacking with a Wolf Champion. Kyle going down to 14, and is once again facing a wolf coming in, trying to get back on this board and try to turn this game around.
Yeah, I think Sam Black recognized, you know, he had that too, those two ice strikes the previous game.
Wow, and I think this is a Kyle like, hey, look at all these cards I have, but I can't deal with this. This is it's too much for me. I have a deck that's built to attack in big chunks, but it's really hard to play from behind. So, Kyle sees the writing on the wall here and gives it to Sam Black, who's off to a good start. And we'll see Kyle on the rest. And hear from my, being whispered in my ear that time was called there. So even though Kyle might have wanted to fight longer, it was not allowed.